Wham, wham, wham. It's another TromBonus episode. It's just Rob, Celine, Engineer Joey, and a pocket full of dreams as we bro down with a band that is quite literally big in Japan. Motherfucking Zebrahead. All that and more on Checkered Past, the Ska'd cast. What up, Checkerheads? Welcome to Checkered Past, the Ska'd cast with Celine and Rob, the show where a Skama Itachi and a Bucko Nine-Tailed Fox explore the history and impact of a different band each episode and hope to bring in new fans along the way. I'm Rob, and this is my sister and co-host, Celine.
Hi. So, Japanese stuff?
Yeah. Japanese, like, monsters, like yokai.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's fair.
Kama Itachi is the scythe weasel.
And then you're talking about the kitsune?
Yeah.
Nine-Tailed Fox, which I have tatted on my chest.
That's right. Like, I thought it was relevant.
Chest tat.
Oh yeah, there's somebody else here. And because it's a TromBonus, we have Engineer Joey.
Hi, I'm here. I've been the regular co-host the last couple of times.
Oh yeah, wow. This is a full
boo indeed.
Boo. The full compliment, as they say.
We're all here. Gang's all here.
The gang's all here.
Gang's all here.
The gang's all here.
Yep.
Do you have a Celine in? Do you want to do a Celine?
Oh, yeah.
Celine in. Celine's going to talk for a minute.
Oh, that's good, actually.
You're
not going to remember
one.
It next
no,
time.
No, it was different
but,
than last time.
No, it was, but this one was a good one.
That was a good one. I'll never remember. Too much pressure already.
Right.
I went to the Calgary Expo and dressed up as Jar Jar Binks.
Right.
As Twitter has seen. And every social media platform I could post on his scene. I, like, low-key did expect it to go viral, and so far, at least on TikTok, but there's still time.
Yeah.
TikTok takes a bit.
Maybe they'll drop the Jar Jar movie and it'll get a revival at some point or something.
I did get a girl that came up to me and said it was the funniest costume she'd ever seen and got a picture with me. So, and then the Calgary Expo tweeted at me saying, haha, Jar Jar. So,
those are really good reviews.
And then one TikTok comment said, Celine, what is this?
That means it's
which
somebody
I like.
You know.
Yes.
That's even better.
Which I like. Yeah. And then the other comment was just, ha 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 ha, what? So things are going pretty well for me.
So what song did you play? What somebody wise once told me that you get popular TikToks by playing a popular song.
Yeah, I should have done it, but like I had heard this really song that it was like kind of dumb. It's just called Hiding That I'm Sexual. I don't think I just was like, to me, that was very funny about like Jar Jar being like hiding that I'm sexual, or you could think about like that I'm saying that I'm hiding that I'm sexual and me being sexual is dressing up as Jar Jar Binks. So it's just very funny to me. But I should have chose a popular song. But I don't think Gen Z maybe likes Jar Jar. I think that might be a millennial thing.
Oh, maybe that's it. Maybe you just should have done it
all
10
it was,
years ago.
Everyone that was there, or like 70% of the people dressed up were like Gen Z anime kids. Like My Hero and Demon Slayer, almost exclusively.
My Hero Academia?
Yeah.
How many froppers were there?
A few. Yeah. A few froppers.
She's my hero. I like Fropper.
Okay, Gen Z.
My Hero Academia.
And then, yeah, anyways, it's a bizarre world out there in youth culture. Like anime, so anime I think is just like big, like it's really big with kids.
Yeah.
It's not for nerdos anymore.
It's big with everybody. Everybody loves anime.
Like it was way more anime there than Marvel.
Yeah.
Mm.
But I also think maybe the young people were less scared of COVID and the oldies were like, maybe I shouldn't go to this.
That's possible too.
Because it was too much. It was too much. I had a mask under my Jar Jar mask and we still hid.
Did you get any sweet swag?
I found this I got this stuffy in this like tarot deck from this like artist, like kind of like, she's Canadian. I don't know where she's from, but it's very cute. It's like a little like Satan ram, fuzzy little lammy thing. It was very cute.
She's doing one of these things.
It might as well be. The Baphomet style.
Rob's doing the Baphomet pose.
You've never looked more badass.
I know a thing. Are we all impressed that Rob knows a thing?
So is Zebrahead... Wait.
Are we doing that? Oh, yeah, that's a great segue.
I was going to say, Zebrahead is kind of a Baphomet.
I was going to ask if they are Japanese or they're big in Japan.
No, definitely
not. They're just big in Japan?
Huge in Japan.
Okay, I'm like completely unfamiliar. I thought I was, but I'm like, I have no idea what they sound like.
Let's get into it. Now, that's like the best segue. We went from Baphomet immediately into Zebrahead. It's like a bird scooter.
That's what I'm here for. Smooth transitions.
So as we've been doing with the TromBonus, we've been soliciting our patrons for suggestions on what to do. So shout out to past and future guest Common Sense Kid, a.k.a. Craig, a.k.a. Craigy Baby, a.k.a. Craig the Masala Masta. I don't know.
A.k.a. Diddy Kong of... Ska Punk International.
Yep. AKA, I don't know. That's it.
He's got many AKAs.
AKA the worst.
But he had recommended Zebrahead. We are ready. Like, I'll say, I've had this episode queued up for probably 4 months. Like, I knew Zebrahead was somebody we were going to want to do at some point.
Speaking of Craigie and Zebrahead, did you guys see that he just got the latest Zebrahead vinyl on, like, some sort of neon nuclear fucking green? It looks amazing.
It looks incredible.
Looks very cool.
For the brand new EP that
and
just came
out.
And
wasn't it Chip who recommended this or no?
No, Chip did the last episode.
Who recommended this one?
Craig.
Oh, it was Craig.
It was Craig, yeah. He's a big Zebrahead fan. He, in fact, also sent a playlist on Spotify of ska and ska adjacent Zebrahead songs, including a bunch that I hadn't really listened to before. So
what I decided
to do with this episode to kind of roll through this is rather than just playing all the ska songs, I'm going to go album by album because they have a lot. They have like 15 albums, I don't think. So I'm just going to go album by album. I've picked 12. So either I'm going to play a ska song or a ska adjacent song or just a song that was really popular off of that album so that we can follow their trajectory from their start to their finish. Just to start.
Because you killed them.
That's right.
Got it.
Yeah. They are still around. So I'll start there. But they've been around since 96.
Oh,
they're not a ska band.
They're not a ska band.
They are not a ska band.
But they started in 96.
But they started in 96.
Are they ska adjacent?
In California. Well, how about I don't ruin it for you?
We're talking about them, so I guess they obviously are.
We'll start off with their debut album, which was their self-titled one. So there's some key people you should know about this band. There's Allie and Justin, who are on the vocals, and Greg, who is the lead guitarist. Those names will come up a couple of times. So their debut album was self-released in 1998, 2 years after they began. And why don't we get an idea of what they sound like? This is a ska-adjacent song from their yellow album, Zebrahead, Song 10.
This is wild. Okay. That's a lot of things happening. What's he saying?
I don't know. Something very aggro.
I don't. It's too many things.
The ad-libs are so loud.
So loud. Makes me want to do that.
Why?
Makes me want to get right up in Flynn's face.
That.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Do you guys like this?
It's all right.
You like that?
It's
okay.
Fine. It's fine.
So what are they for? Are they British?
No, they're from California.
You said that.
California.
So their whole deal, especially in the 90s, was that they didn't want to be a ska band because everybody was doing ska in
they're
the 90s.
They're barely a band.
I associate them with kind of like the same thing as what like Phoenix TX was doing, I feel like. Or Mest, where they were sort of like part of the crew of like that not quite A-tier pop punk group that was sort of doing their thing, but all those bands kind of were a little more eclectic. They weren't just doing kind of the same thing as Blink-182. That's what, how I always kind of thought of Zebrahead from that period.
Were they big in North America?
Oh, so we'll get into that in a second. So I think that's just as good of a time to go on to the next, because I love the discussion that we're having as we discover what kind of a band they are. So in the same year they released their debut, they released the album Waste of Mind on Columbia. So they got a big record deal off of this. And
everyone loved it. Yeah. So people couldn't get enough.
They couldn't get enough. They're just, and so here is the song Jag Off.
It like hurts.
Very Sublimey.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, but the timing. Timing is so weird.
Can't live without me. Where you run off to? Wait,
guitar. I do like guitars, but that's not a guitar.
No, he's a guitar.
Yeah. Like, oh, guitar. Like the dark guitar.
Like our uncle. Yeah, like our uncle
guitar. Okay.
So I'll say that their deal probably at this time is kind of a little bit closer to what you're saying, but they were really into just doing funk. That was like their whole deal is rap, funk.
Yeah, and rap. Rapping, there was a lot of funking. Rapping.
Yeah.
They were on a lot of
It's not just rap funk, though.
No.
Then we'd be talking about like Renegade Against the Machine, you know?
Renegade Against the Machine. Rage Against the Machine.
Rage Against the Machine. Renegades of Funk.
Renegades of Funk.
Yeah. I made Renegade Renegades of Against the Machine. Is funk rap.
Yeah.
Rap
funk. Well, that's something else. At the time, I feel like I was into rap rock.
That's more listenable than this.
I was into like rap rock as it was coming up, and I was into skateboarding and punk rock and pop punk at the time. And these guys, I felt like, were kind of straddling that. Like, they weren't metal enough to be included in like rap metal at all, but they were overly rappy for pop punk, so they didn't really fit in with like Sum 41 and whatnot, or whatever was just the just precursor to that, because it would have been a couple of years before that. But
yeah,
it's giving me Johnny Sacco vibes, honestly.
So Allie,
there's like a weird academic music thing here or something.
I would say academic music. I don't know.
Well,
I feel like
the timing is weird.
This is Meathead.
You think it's like, Meathead?
These are some edgelord ass lyrics. I don't know if you're catching.
No, I'm not. I'm literally not catching a single lyric. I don't know what they've said other than yeah.
Yeah, they talk about their dicks all the time.
Okay, I hate that.
Who
are their fans? I guess Craig. Our good
and the entire country of Japan is a huge fan.
And skate and snowboarders in the late 90s.
100% So they, off of this album.
So everyone just liked them because they were edgy?
Kind of. And so, but I feel like this was a thing that happened during this time. I'm thinking, what's that band? Like Good Charlotte used to do shit like this too, where they would just like.
They've done nothing like this.
Are you kidding?
Are you saying like
Good
they did?
Charlotte?
And Messed is another good example of dick joke bands.
Oh, dick joke bands. I thought you were talking about sound.
Every punk band did it. Heavy on the dick jokes. All dick jokes.
Yeah.
All dick jokes.
Shake it once, that's fine. Shake it twice, that's okay. Shake it three times, you're playing with yourself again.
Yep. Correct. In case you didn't knew it the first time. That's a dick joke.
Take off your pants and jacket.
Take off your pants and
jacket. Yeah, but that's a dick joke. This is like, this is different.
Speaking of.
This is more AC/DC or Kiss where they're just writing a song about their dick, you feel?
You know I like Kiss.
Speaking of jokes about jerking off, their next album was called Playmate of the Year.
Okay.
And this song was a hit.
This was a hit. Huge song. I remember this song coming out. Yep. If you know this song, there's almost no rapping on it because this is Justin, the other singer, just being a singer and playing pop punk, and it is a song.
Are you guys hearing that breakbeat and scratching in the background there?
Okay, well, this this makes more sense.
Yeah.
This is an actual song.
Oh, it's an earworm.
It's like a very poppy song.
This is like,
Talking about his boner?
Oh, I don't like that.
She's going to my head.
Gonna make this milky clear.
That's gross. I don't like this. I can see why it got popular, but it's gross, and I
very
don't like
popular
it.
In the year
teenage
2000.
Boys my age.
Yeah.
Me. This that was directed at me.
I will say, I think Justin is a pretty good singer. It's too bad that all he sang about was his dick.
Yeah, like that song sound like if you put that on a compilation with that the. What's the dealio? That messed song and like a good Charlotte song. Like that was just
it's
the 2000s.
Like
that was summer 2000. Yeah.
But like that's way better than this.
I warned you.
This is kind this
I
is
warned
kind of
Celine
like the lowest
record.
Common denominator of like all of that.
I'm going to say, so we're three albums in. Playmate of the Year, the album.
There's no
is
like.
So good. It is the guiltiest pleasure for me. I listen to that whole album and I'm like, it's not good.
It's also not for me. It was never for me. Yeah.
It
was
it
never
be
made
for
women. For
me either. But I listen to it and I'm like, you know what? This is
but
fun.
But I can like this is fun. I can like a dick joke once in a while. But
what about a whole album of dick jokes?
No, and this is just gross.
Would it surprise you to know they are very good friends with Real Big Fish?
Probably. That makes sense.
Yeah, very good friends. They would tour together all the time. They were like actually like friendly outside of work, if you will. They would just bro down, hang out.
That's fun.
There's a guy in Edmonton with zebra stripes tattooed on his head. But I doubt it's for the band.
I don't think so. I don't think zebras have anything to do with Zebrahead.
What? Since when?
I actually don't. What is the?
Yeah, what's the name?
You know what?
Story?
While we play the next song, I'm gonna. But I have something to say about the next song. I should figure out why they're called that. Yeah. The next album they had is Motherfucking Zebrahead. No word of a lie. That's the album.
That's
MFZB.
Funny.
And they changed their sound. So let's see.
I think
if
that's
their
funny.
Change of their
calling
sound.
Themselves Motherfucking Zebrahead is funny. I like that.
Yeah.
But we'll see if their
Ready?
Change of their sound is
I
appealing
don't think
to
I will, because you're saying it like that.
Pow. They're the Strokes now.
I already like it better. Oh, no, never mind. I take it back. I know. Another tragedy in the news. There's someone shooting down the right to choose. It doesn't seem at all they chose the right. This is way better.
I like this.
Way
better. Much
better.
Oh, salads-esque.
Yes.
Kind of like a Rise Against sort of.
Yeah, Rise Against. Yeah. Oh, yeah. 2003, does that make sense? Pretty close.
Yeah, it's about, right around that time for sure.
Someone
that mid-tempo,
rescue me.
Like.
Yeah,
I don't mind that. I don't mind that. That's pretty, that's kind of RX Bandits-y almost.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Like, less emo, but still more emo than what they were doing before.
Yeah.
The dick jokes are all but gone on this album.
That's fine.
Better.
That does make me feel
better.
This
is they're a fun party band.
Okay.
This is not a fun party
album. I like, it sounds darker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
100%. It was
they've had some life experience.
It was the 2003 era of, music. So, you heard the jangly, garage rock, strokesy intro, a little bit more emo.
I actually don't mind that. I did not like the other stuff, but this was good.
This is a stark difference.
Yes.
Stark
much,
difference.
Much better.
All right. Well, we found a song.
I like a Zebrahead song.
You like what's a Zebrahead? Rescue Me.
What is it, four albums into 15?
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
That's
before halfway through their career, so this band might win you over.
Yeah.
Because
there are more changes to come.
There's more changes.
Yeah, they definitely are a chameleon kind of band. That's another thing that I've always kind of equated with them is they've never had a, like, they've had a consistent sound, but not in the way that, I don't know, Strung Out has had, or a band that sounds
Strung Out.
Yeah, well, they like they've changed their sound over the years, but they've always had like a very specific metal-y punky sort of sound.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Where Zebrahead like has this like party pop punk with rap sort of thing that has is
party
a through
pop
line.
Punk with rap is like is, they're is, on their gravestone.
Yeah, like that's their through line, but they've always been very chameleon-y, sort of changing around from that basic formula for sure.
I think it's just because people will just eat their shit up no matter what they do.
Yeah.
Like their whole shtick is for people, like especially Japan.
Yeah.
So how did it happen? Japan just took to it organically?
Yeah.
Like
literally, and then they have Japan only releases for every album. Wow. They have so many Japan only EPs.
Hey.
They just go there and they crush.
Sweet. Might as well.
Good for them, right?
Yeah.
Do it. That's fun. Maybe because they're so like, yeah, because they're like, I don't know.
But who else is doing this?
Yeah, I guess.
Like, and whether or not anybody should, like, the fact is that there is nobody out there doing, like, pop punk with rap and dick jokes, and that's still their thing. Like, I don't know, maybe slightly stupid, but even then they're, like, not even, like, punk anymore. They're just, like, they're basically just
like a
sublime rap
reggae
thing,
band,
right?
Kinda, yeah.
But, like, all that stuff is, like, yeah, Cottonmouth Kings.
But even then, I would say that airs more to the nu metal side.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's right.
Like with reggae or something. Like.
What about? Did you say Cypress Hill? That's not, I guess, punk enough though.
No, that's just rap.
That's just rap.
Straight up.
Well, they did have a rap rock.
They had
a
rap rock.
Yeah, that's
they did.
True. Right. You want to be a rock superstar?
That's what I was thinking of. Be real.
What about
Be real?
Project Wise. Project Wise again. No punk.
Project Wise.
Now you're just
how many times
rap rock?
Project Wise gonna get brought up on this show before
until we do a Trump bonus
until
about him.
Until we do a Trump bonus about him, or we get them on the pod.
Mocha might be available, and I confront that guy about his
Mocha
hair only not from Project Wise. He was from.
Oh, wait, which one is that one?
Swollen Members.
That's who I was thinking of.
I was thinking about. Yeah. I was thinking about Swollen Members.
Swollen Members is sweet. That's good.
That's kind of rock punk.
There's no rock. It's just
rap.
Just
rap, yeah.
It's kind of punky rap, but it's like skate culture rap.
Skate culture rap.
Like a Lupe Fiasco.
Yeah, definitely.
It's like a skate
Lupe
rapper.
Yeah. Okay, I guess.
This is quite the diversion.
This is not ska-related or even Zebrahead related.
What'd you come up with for their name?
For their name? It doesn't say.
No, just nothing, hey? I
also Googled not very well.
Cool.
So why don't I type this question in? Okay, why are they called Zebrahead? Okay.
That's good.
While that's going, the next album, is called Broadcast to the World. I actually skipped over a B-sides one just because I didn't feel like doing it. But Justin had left. He's the singer guy.
Okay.
So the singing guy has changed.
Justin, the singer left.
The singer's gone.
Do you know why?
The rapper, yeah, he went on to form a really bad band called I Hate Kate.
Huh?
I think I had that album.
Maybe that's why
good.
He was.
I did not like it.
So angry, and had to write about his dick so much.
Yeah, it was pretty. It was pretty aggro. So they brought Maddie in, Maddie Lewis, and they kind of shifted back to being a little bit more fun, but a little bit more of the. So it's more in line with like the pop punk of the time, which would have been 2006.
Okay.
So think 2006 pop punk.
A little more emo-y, a little more 80s influence.
It was a very emo time, I feel like.
Yeah.
It was a very emo time.
It was.
It was the emoest 2006? Of times. It was the punk of times.
It was a really emo time.
So this is a song called Anthem.
Throw all your hands up. Yeah, this sounds like it's from 2006 so far.
She don't know it yet. Got a six string. Best friends just with the broken neck. Wanna make my mark, change the world with this flow. But all this doubt in my head, it won't. Now I'm on my
doors. Okay, so that's ska.
Full blown.
That's all. This is pretty good.
Get up, and the good times roll.
not bad.
I like Maddie's.
Yeah, I like this new singer. Yeah. It's good. I do like the rap guy's screamy, yelly kind of register as well, though. Like, he has a good... It's like a good mix of what he can do in the band.
Yeah, he's not quite Skinhead Rob.
Not quite there.
Vocals are like a little put on. It's a, like almost like the TikTok sound. Like, tonight will be the night that I will die for you.
Yeah.
Oh, you're talking. Again. This but is also of the time. Like, Postal Service would have been out.
Yeah, well, and also that Blink 182 album with the most Tom DeLonging on it came out in right around.
Oh, and I also Angels and Airwaves would have been out at this time.
Yeah, with like I Miss You. Yeah, that was on that album that came out right around 2006.
Where are you?
Yeah.
And I'm so sorry.
That's right.
Where are you?
I like it. So, anyway, the band is named after a movie.
Oh, okay.
The movie is called Zebrahead from 1992.
Is it good?
I don't know. I didn't even know it was a movie until I Googled. Did you rent it on VHS? Why are they called Zebrahead?
Hmm? Did you rent it on VHS?
Probably 1992. I would have rented it on VHS.
I bet they would have rented it on VHS.
Tweet at us. Tweet at us.
Tweet at us.
Tweet at us. Tweet at us if the movie's good.
Yeah.
Sean Harris of The Matches did the artwork for that album, and he also does the next one.
The Matches. This is very Matches-esque.
I love The Matches.
And I like The Match. I like
And of the Time.
An album.
And of the Time. We saw them at Warped Tour in 2005. This would have been... Like Yvonne Dahl Killed the Locals era Matches, which was my favorite era. Nah, no, that's true. I like all of them. Their next album was Phoenix in 2008. My hot take, more of the same.
Okay.
Kind of samey. Here we go.
The song's called Mike Dexter is a God.
I don't mind this.
I love this song. It's a good song. Really good song.
This is fun.
Isn't that harmony in the back?
And ska, little?
Yeah.
This is pretty fun.
I did say more of the same, but this album, Phoenix, when it came out, I listened to it a lot. I forgot that I listened to it like all the time. I don't know what it was about that time in my life where, same thing with Zebrahead, is like I pop in and out of them. Like I'll not listen to them at all for like 10 years. And then all of a sudden be like, oh, a new Zebrahead. I should probably listen to that. And then I'll check it out.
I'm fighting a sneeze right now.
Oh, then that means we need to take a break. And when we get back, more Zebrahead. Welcome back to Checkered Past. Rob, Celine, and Joey here talking Zebrahead. And we just left off on the album Phoenix, and we're going into their next album called Panty Raid. And I'm not going to say a whole lot about it. Gross. Why don't we play the song? They tried to make me go to rehab, but I said no, no, no.
Yes, I've been black, but when I come back, you'll no, no, no. That's kind of fun. I ain't got the time, and if my daddy thinks I'm fine. This is pretty good, actually.
Yeah, this is good.
This is very good.
The horns?
This is a very good cover. There's nothing fun fact, Amy Winehouse's song is the cover of this. That's better than rapping. Screaming's better than rapping.
Why ain't got the time? And if my daddy thinks I'm fine. Anyway,
that's fun. I like that.
That album is all covers.
Oh,
and
that's
it's
huge.
All covers of female pop songs.
Okay, so they're redeeming themselves, but it's called Panty Raiders? Okay. I mean, it was close.
I mean, that...
Who else?
Oh, let's see what else they got on there. They got Beyonce, Survivor.
That's fun.
Girls Just Want to Have Fun. Underneath It All, the Gwen Stefani song.
Yeah.
London Bridge, the Fergie song. Huh?
Was the Underneath It All, did they do it like reggae-y kind of? That makes sense.
My name is Fergie Ferg and we love you long time. Holds up.
I mean, they're popular in Japan.
I'm sure it was very popular in 2009 when the album came out. There are so many covers on here. There are 16 covers on this
Mickey,
album.
That's funny. They do Mickey.
That is very funny. They do Who Let the Dogs Out, which is funny.
Get the Party Started, which everyone knows is the best Pink song.
Is that
the only good Pink song, honestly. Spice Up Your Life, that's sweet.
Everybody Love a Girl.
Jenny from the Block.
Yeah, these are good. I'm going to have to maybe listen block, to this. Like, I would actually listen to
that. Get back
to
me when it's Joey from the Block.
No.
No. So now we go to 2000. This is something that you might like, is 2011. So they have the album Get Nice. So they hook up with Jason Fries, will be their producer for a while. Mm-hmm. Does that name sound familiar?
No.
No.
He is related to...
Josh
Fries.
Okay.
Exactly.
I know Josh.
Josh Fries is his brother.
Oh, okay. So,
and he plays... And Jason Fries plays the saxophone.
Oh.
That's funny.
Did he play on like...
The Vandals?
Really early one that...
You know he did.
What the hell was that song? The dance song. I'm for Lady Killer. Yeah.
If there was saxophone on the Vandals,
I'm pretty sure there's saxophone on
Josh,
Lady Killer.
So Josh Fries is a very famous session drummer.
Okay.
He was the drummer for the Vandals.
And everyone he played in Perfect Circle. He played in, I think he played for Danny Elfman at Coachella just recently.
He is like a, like Travis Barker wishes he was Josh Fries.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And his drum videos are insane. Like when you watch him play fast music, it's like I've watched multicam drum videos of him and he's like effortlessly doing things.
People don't talk about the Vandals more as like a perfect
band. Like, like even way back, like Hitler's Bad, Vandals Good is like, here, 15-year-old, play any of these songs on
a
guitar.
That's funny.
No.
Hitler's Bad.
Hitler Bad, Vandals Good is
the best one.
The best album title that anybody has ever come up with. It's perfect.
And to like stick with it, like that's Hitler's like bad. Definitely was a joke. And they're like, no, this is actually what we're calling. Like it went through several edits and people.
And I think that their jokes hold up. I don't know. I've probably revisited.
I've listened to that album recently because it's my favorite one, and all of the jokes do hold up.
Like,
Cafe 405 is maybe a little sus because he was already kind of like old to be singing about a teenage girl, but all of their songs are dripping in so much satire and sarcasm that clearly it's
like
not
in my backyard is probably more prescient now than it was in the 90s. And they have that song about mullets, which is incredible.
Yeah,
and also the I've got an idea for a movie.
God, they're so funny.
It goes like this. So good.
Anyway, the Vandals are amazing, and the saxophone brother definitely produced the Zebrahead album. And this is the last album to feature Greg, their original lead guitarist.
Well, I think I know who comes in.
I think you do. Anyway, this song's called Nudist Priest. I don't love that title.
That's funny. I like that. Nudist Priest is funny.
2011, by the way.
Pretty ska.
Super ska.
This is fun.
They got hooks,
that's
man.
That's not bad.
Yeah, it's good.
Hooks.
Yeah.
I got it. Like, this is where they turn a corner and it's just the catchiest shit ever.
Yeah, okay.
Everything is about like a sing along.
So, what? This had the new guitarist?
The next album. Called Call Your Friends features.
And what's his deal? Who is he?
Dan Palmer.
From what?
The fucking mustache.
The mustache from Death by Stereo.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
And that's pretty cool.
He shreds.
He fucking rules. And yeah. He rules in Zebrahead. Okay. It is wild how good a guitar player he is. Death by Stereo is taking over the world.
Death by Stereo is one of my favorite bands, and the fact that now they're just dispersing each of their members to a band in a different genre is just, they're just like taking
and
over.
And making them good. Like the Voodoo Glow Skulls.
But they're still a band, right?
Song was so good.
Yeah, they're still a band, but then also Dan playing in Zebrahead.
I don't think they tour, really.
They have more recently because Death by Stereo kind of went away for a little bit, and I think everybody did side project-y stuff. And then they put out an EP, I want to say 3 or 4 years ago, then they just recently put out like a longer release. Because
I'm sure if Dan's in Zebrahead, he's tour, because they tour like fucking crazy.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that's like soaking up his time.
But, I follow him on Instagram because it's very entertaining.
He's
it's
amazing.
And also I like, it gives me insight into what's going on with Death by Stereo and Voodoo Glow Skulls. So I want to know about both because they're awesome.
So this song is not a ska song. Not really. It's called Call Your Friends. It was a single, 2013. So new guitar player.
Classic pop punk vocals, pop punk lyrics. Like,
I think that like going into the 2010s, I think they just doubled down.
That guy's mustache is crazy. I'm just looking at
Dan Palmer. He's called a mustache for a reason.
And
the
beret doesn't take away from the mustache.
And then he just shreds on that, like, whatever, ESP Les Paul or whatever it is he plays.
Yeah, the new lead singer was for sure a daddy.
Oh, the new lead singer?
What's his rating? Give him rank.
Wait. I think that might be the new singer.
That's a new?
Yeah, so you gotta hold
there's
that.
There's a bunch of lead singers.
Yeah, they've had three. Justin, Maddie, and then a new one. So hold tight.
And then the same rap guy the whole time.
Yes, Ali is the like main rap guy since the beginning.
Here's a 2015.
And he's the muscly guy, right? That's with a bunch of tattoos.
He's cute, too.
He's muscly with a bunch of tattoos, right? Yes. That guy? Yeah.
Yeah, and he's Southeast Asian descended,
he's
I think.
Very
yeah.
cute.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say it like kind of goes from not as daddy to daddy. It's like a 7, 8, 9 from what I can see.
Just moving from just
upward. Yeah, sorry guys, but 7, 8, 9.
And what about the rap guy?
Oh, like, I don't know. He didn't stand
out. He's consistent.
Is he the guy yelling?
I want to say he's the guy jumping right there.
No, that's a new hottie. That's new hottie. Oh, yeah.
Wait 1 second then.
There's some serious research going on right here.
Oh,
we gotta get to the bottom.
I mean, he just looks
meter.
Like a guy. He's pretty average. He just looks like a guy.
But we talking like madness like average?
Yeah. That's
no, average. No. We're talking like probably an 8.
That's pretty high for average. High
yeah, he's
average.
Not. A, he's not a bad looking guy. Oh whoa, with the shirt off, things have changed.
Yeah.
All right, we're at an 8. We're at a healthy 8.
Allie's rose.
So 8 for the rap guy and
with his shirt
7, 8, 9 for the singers. What about the mustache? What does he get?
Oh, he's fun.
He's off the scale.
Yeah, that cannot be Raven.
He's a multiple genre.
He's too
daddy.
Much of
he's
a cartoon.
Not just a ska daddy.
Yeah,
he's too much of a
cartoon to be rated.
He's like an asterisk and an ampersand sign.
Yeah,
N/A.
Yeah, they're.
So we moved to 2015. I remember when this album came out, Walk the Plank, and I was like, Joey, I think you'll like it. It's got hooks. And anyway, the song that I queued up is called Battle Hymn. Nothing really has changed, but let's listen to what this is all about. Fiber slap. Did y'all catch that?
Tam. Yeah. You're Tam. Sick. Tam.
This one's actually got kind of like a Tim Armstrong Rancid-y interrupters-y kind of like.
Very interrupter-y. Yeah. Yeah.
Very Fifi Dobson-esque.
Yeah.
Sick Tam.
Sick Tam. I know they're not a ska band, and I know the type of ska that they play is, like, you know, just a B minus, maybe a C. You know, I know it's not, like, the best ska in the world, but oh, there's something
but
about
it's
it.
It's better than something Millen Collins ska.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good point.
It's better than Millen Collins, period.
Oh. Whoa, spicy yeah, take.
Definitely, I would stand by that.
I think that was the entire treatise of that episode, was Celine's distaste for Millen Collins.
So boring. Boring.
Bad
at least
tones.
This is fun, and they're having fun with it and trying things.
It's true.
Yeah. Trying all kinds of stuff. It's working.
Trying shirts on, shirts off.
Trying mustache waxes at this point.
That guy's mustache is wild.
Yeah,
you're not over.
I can't know. Mustache, truly
mustache. It's pretty impressive.
I was like, well, that's clearly Mustache Dan.
Yeah, like, if you're just like showing a, like, just listener, Google Zebrahead. Try to find the mustache.
Yeah, the mustache, yeah.
Try to find it. You'll find it easy to find.
Yeah, so same thing with Death by Stereo.
When's the hottie Google coming in?
Oh, almost there. So there's one more album with Maddie called Brain Invaders that came out in 2019, and the song I've queued up is called You Don't Know Anything About Me.
I know you have cute little spiky hair. Ska?
Get that horn.
Oh.
Now, are these like a borrowed horn section from Real Big Fish or something?
What do you say?
First try. Whoa, Joey. Nailed it.
Well, you mentioned that they were like bros earlier, so.
Paying attention, too.
Very hooky. So many hooks. It's like a tackle box with so many hooks.
Just hooks for days.
Yeah.
I'd say... That's good.
Like, oh, that record slow at the horns. That was cool. I liked it.
2000 and...
Did you say what horns they were?
Real Big Fish's horns.
They're the exact horns of Real Big Fish.
Yeah, the horn section of
the
Real Big
very
Fish.
The very ones.
It's the horn section of the Real Big Fish.
That's, yep, the Real Big horn
Matt
section.
Matt Appleton, Billy Cottage, the other guy.
It does sound like that.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It's like the most Real Big Fish sound. Yeah, like
he had mentioned
era.
That they were like friends, and as soon as I heard the way those stabs happened, I was like, oh, that's a very Real Big Fish sounding horn section.
Bros. And they're bros. And they just like wrote a straight up ska punk song.
And it seems like in the 2000s, if you were a band that didn't have your own horn section and you had a horn section on it, it was either Less Than Jake's or Real Big Fish's. It sounds like.
Seems like it. That's what we're learning. Real Big Fish, like, pimped out their horn section to anybody who would take them.
Yeah.
Like, that was the thing.
Which is smart when you think about it. That's just, like, free advertising for your band, especially when your genre is not doing great, even though you're putting out great albums at that time.
And now you want the time that you've been
waiting.
I'm
curious if I'm going to like it.
So now, the EP is called Three. It just came out. And the reason why they call it three is because they consider it their third era because Justin, Maddie, new singer, right? One, two, three. And I'd say I'd say the new sound is different enough to warrant that. The EP only has five songs. There is one ska-ish song on here. So you can listen and decide, does the looks match the singing?
Does the drapes match its cover?
Does the looks match the drapes? Russian roulette is for lovers.
That's some hard sounding guitar. That's
Death
cool.
by Stereo guitar.
That's more Death by Stereo. Yeah. Dan Ezreal metal.
Chugga chugga chugga.
You gotta die penniless, worldwide. This it is,
living for others, never made any motherfucking sense. Cause you're not good enough. This is rap.
This is
fun. It's kind of Suicide Machine too, sort of.
Oh. It's a very good singer. A beautiful voice. What can I say?
I'm gonna comment about that after a song.
That's sick. This is incredible. That's an incredible singer.
Sings like the Linkin Park guy.
That's probably why I like it
like
so
Chester?
Much.
Yeah.
That is why you like it so much.
and you had mentioned Rage Against the Machine. Ali kind of sometimes raps a little bit.
I mentioned
like that.
Yeah,
Renegade
totally.
Against the Machine.
I know. So Rick Della Poca from Renegade Against the Machine is what he raps like.
So where's that guy? Like, what's his story?
The new singer?
Yeah, is he from something?
He was from a
can't just come out of
punk
nowhere.
Band that kind of was semi-big on the 2018 Warped
okay.
Tour.
Oh, that's fun.
And so,
what band?
I, you know what? I looked it up and I didn't recognize the name.
He's a very, like a really, did any screams too?
Yeah.
He's very
modern pop punk bands like you kind of have to do that.
That scream at the end was pretty
good. That was the rapper?
Good.
That was
that
his.
Sounded like the singer.
His name is
sounded like the singer.
Adrian Estrella is the name of the new singer.
That sounds familiar.
And he's from a band called Assuming We Survive.
Oh, that is not familiar.
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
I don't know that band either, but so that's it. That's Zebrahead.
That's
Celine.
Fun, and that's just cool. What they sound like now?
Yeah, that's
and he's only done
like.
One album,
one EP. Five
when,
songs.
Oh, and when was that?
That's that brand new one that
this
just
year.
Came out.
Yeah.
Oh, that was this year.
I think so.
This is all
or was
new?
It last year? It was within the last like 12 months.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what
that
they sound
pretty,
like.
That's good. I like it. It's very different though. Like all of those singers, it sounds like completely different bands.
Right.
Their sound from when they started to now is
wildly
incomparable.
Different. Yeah. They went from
like
this,
I actually like that. It's
funk. Punk rap.
I hated
dick
the beginning.
Thing
I hated
to
the
like,
beginning.
I think they still do. Dick
it's crazy
jokes,
that they even go by the same name. That's how different they are.
Yeah,
it kind of boggles my mind to be honest.
But like I said, they've been changing since that first second album. Like I
also
always,
like I can respect the change. Too.
Yeah, like I've
be
been
playing.
Kind of
I definitely wouldn't
peripherally
want to...
following their career for almost the whole time.
Yeah,
I would say,
too.
And I always like kind of known that they were a band that sort of shifts gears from
so
album
like,
to album. So
like when they tour, though, you know
they play like all the songs.
Yeah, they play.
Do they?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I would bet you any money they get into what streams the most in Japan for their old songs, and they make a playlist out of it, or like they do their set like that because like with the kind of success they have in Japan, that's the way I'd be doing it, like to know what songs are really hitting because you have such a variety of songs and a variety of sounds, you know.
Yeah, and they just it's nice to know there's like a workhorse band out there that just plugs away at it and just keeps. Firing on all cylinders. Like, I know they're not modern. Nothing about them sounds very modern. They're still doing, like, the pop punk stuff
but that's
that
also,
done.
Like, big now, too, though.
Yeah. They've
coming back around.
Yeah,
they've been doing it long
doing
enough
it.
That it's coming back
it's
around.
It's coming back around for them.
Just like Avril.
They do well. Yeah. They make money. They tour. Fuck, I
like
I got
them
nothing.
More than MGK.
Oh. Jeez. Oh. Like, there's, like, a taste in my mouth. Like, it's, like, pine needles.
I'd
like,
rather listen to this. Saying,
yeah. Yeah. I'd rather listen to, like, Heart Surgery where the person's still alive than MGK.
It's not good.
Anyway. Oh, hey, look, it's probably time to close out this episode. Thanks for listening to Checkered Past. Am I overriding everybody? No, that's good. Hit us up on Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok at Checkered Past Pod, or send us an email at checkeredpastpod@gmail.com. To support the podcast, you can sign up for the Checkerhead Patreon to get this episode uncut in both audio and video format. Or you can buy some merch at checkeredpast.ca.
Uncircumcised videos.
Uncircumcised.
Please like, subscribe, tell your friends, and rate us 5 stars on Apple Podcasts. This episode is produced and engineered by Joey, who also makes playlists featuring music from today's episode. Our theme song is OAO by Edmonton's own Mad Bomber Society. Next week, we will have Vin Diesel on the program to discuss We Are the Union. No, that can't be right. Anyway, it'll be something special. Until next time, I'm Rob.
I'm Celine.
I'm Engineer Joey.
And in the immortal words of Zebrahead, got a time bomb tick, tick, ticking just like Anthrax. Boys want a battle, so I bought me a battle axe.